New head coach Adam Gase, Don LaGreca, and Bob Pischuzin. Love the beard, by the way.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with this.
You just going to see what happens?
Yeah, I think so.
No, it looks good.
I think I'm having a beard off with Matt Patricia. He just doesn't know yet.
All right. Yeah. Are you winning?
You're winning.
No, I don't think so. I think his is like this now.
So how's camp been? What you expected it to be?
It's been good. You know, I've really enjoyed being around our guys. The way they work, these guys don't say anything. They just work hard.
Mm-hmm.
And guys are very inquisitive about when we're installing new things and going against Greg. It's both sides are they're being challenged. Mm-hmm. So guys have it's just the energy level has been outstanding.
And along those lines, who's the voice? And I'm sure you've got several, but who are the guys you are noticing is driving that every day in practice in terms of guys that have their helmets on?
I mean,
got a bunch of them.
You want to guess?
I'll give you one guess.
Yeah. He's on the other side of the ball from me.
Yeah.
Yep.
So.
But don't you have a couple of them on the other side of the ball? What about CJ?
Yeah, but CJ's quiet.
Right.
But he does a lot with actions, but mm-hmm. he knows how he has those conversations. It's just it's not going to be like Jamal. When you walk on the field, it starts right away. Like I'll hear him say something, and then it'll go back and forth. It's just I don't know. He can he does a good job. He can push my buttons really good.
You know, we were here for the press conference in January. You were excited about Sam Darnold working with him. Now you got to work with him a little bit. Is there anything that you've learned? Anything that even excites you more than when you first took a glance at him back in January?
Yeah, some of the throws he makes are ridiculous. When he's just everybody's collapsing on it, he's like square and shoulders are parallel. He just flicks it 50 yards. I'm like, what is that?
Yeah, Bob, you brought that up because I was asking him, do you watch a quarterback and say, boy, I wish I can do that? And he said, Aaron Rodgers, he makes these throws. And Bob reminded us, you mentioned that he can make those throws.
Yeah, his arm looks phenomenal right now. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of people have said it looks stronger, but he went through the combine. He was training for all that. He was kind of tweaking some things. And, you know, when he came in the last spring, I think it was, a little fatigue. And, when you're a rookie and you start playing, you don't understand, all right, maybe I don't throw 5,000 balls a day because in week 15 it's gonna be hurting a little bit.
Yeah.
So he's done a good job of, mm-hmm. We've been keeping track of how many throws he makes. And then he does, when we do our walkthroughs, we're like, don't throw. A lot of times guys will start, screwing around and throwing. And he's done a good job of listening to everything we've asked him to do.
How far back did you go watching him? Did you watch every game last year? Or did you not bother with the first three or four games because he's a rookie? And obviously he was a much different player at the end of last year. How far back did you go in terms of watching him last year?
I think a lot of it is I was watching. I would put cut-ups together.
Right.
And, just watching kind of the first game we played against him last year. Because I remember thinking he was gutting us. He just had a couple turnovers.
Yep.
And we were holding on. I was like, man, if he gets the ball back, we're in trouble. That was an important drive for us. I think we got the ball with 6 minutes left, and we held on to it all the way to the end of the game. And I was really concerned that we weren't going to be able to stop him because he seemed like he was in a pretty good rhythm. The second time we played him, we did a whole bunch of different stuff, and he had never seen any of the things we were doing, and he was jammed up.
Yeah.
And so I watched some games where he played well. I watched some games where he struggled a little bit, and he found ways to make some throws, but there was a few things that I noticed. And the worst one that I did, and he loved this, I went back and watched all his sacks and his interceptions and gave him a little report on it, and he's like, thank you for this.
But when you watched him, any September or October tape, first meeting when you guys had down there, and then you watched those last month of games, after he took a step back, came back in, even calling the games real time, he just looked different. Like throwing with anticipation. The ball's out before a guy's head's even around.
Yep.
It just looked like the game slowed down for him. Did you notice that difference, A, and B, has that carried over into this year?
What happened to him was the best thing that could have happened where he played. I know nobody ever wants to get hurt, but the injury forced him to sit out. He was able to watch Josh, which is Josh is at the point of his career where he's not afraid to make a mistake. He was aggressive, so he kind of got to see. And plus, when you get older, you don't want to get hit anymore either. So Josh was, like, good at getting the ball out, not taking sacks. So when he came back, he kind of was – he got to see that live. It wasn't practice. Mm-hmm. So he was able to see that live, and then he used that to his advantage. I mean, it's – you know, a couple guys that I've talked to around the league, I told him, I'm like, if you're going to play a rookie, play him and then, like, kick him in the leg or something and let him sit out a few days to watch so it's not a big blow-up.
Yeah.
But, I mean, you want him, like, the fact that he sat out, it was almost like he took another jump. Like, he went to year two when he came back. Mm-hmm. And so now we're getting the guy that is building off of that.
Isn't that amazing, though, just because of that position? Like, it would make perfect sense to just say, all right, he's healthy, but you know what? We're going to pull him out for a couple of games. We're going to play our backup just to give him a feel. That would cause such a controversy and a firestorm. You almost want him to get
hurt. That's what I'm saying. You got to kick him in the back of the leg. I hurt his foot or hamstring or something.
How about Bell? You said you want to kick the rust off in the preseason, but how exactly are you going to treat him after missing
the full year? We'll see how this goes. We haven't had that conversation yet. You know, it was... Like last year, I wasn't going to play Frank Gore the whole preseason. And he was in my office every day the third week. He's like, I'm playing. I'm like, how do I argue with this guy?
Right, you
know,
right.
So we haven't had that conversation. I mean, I don't even know how many practices. It feels like we've been here for like 5 months already practicing, but it's only been like five practices. I mean, the days get just, everything is so stacked on right on top of each other. So we haven't had that chance to have that conversation. Mm-hmm. And he's trying to just dig in and learn everything as fast as possible.
His progress has been what, though?
I don't know. I mean, he looks pretty good to me.
He sure looks good.
Like, he had a run today where, you know, it was just like, he just was nice and smooth through the hole, and then all of a sudden it just opened up and he hit it.
Yeah.
And I'm like, all right, I like this.
I just find in sports that when somebody holds out for a significant amount of time, there's that freshness early, but then there's the fatigue later, because eventually it's going to kind of catch up with you, so... How do you deal with that? Because you got to win games, right?
So some guys are physical freaks.
Yeah, and he might be.
Yeah, I mean, what, he touched it like 480 times the one year?
Yeah.
I mean, we're trying to be – I told him, I was like, we're going to use you different than what you've ever done before. Because going through his passing game in Pittsburgh, a lot of his catches were checkdowns, back turn to the defense, turn around, guy taking a shot at his legs, things like that. We want to use him to where he's going to the defense. He can see everything. We want him to be able to catch the ball on the move, make a move, and then go get some yards.
This offseason, since your press conference, has been a soap opera. A lot's happened, you know, with Bell, with McCagnan out, in comes Douglas. And how did you handle all of that? Because there was a lot of negative. There were a lot of opinions getting thrown around. Was it difficult to stay focused, or did
that's
you
why
not
I don't,
care about
that's
it?
Why I don't read anything.
That's
my out. Life has been so boring. I mean, it's like I'm in a cave down there. It's like I don't read the internet. I don't have social media. I'm not watching TV anymore. I'm watching, like, crappy WWF 1983 match.
You don't even shave.
I know.
Right? You just stay in a hole down there.
Well, it's the way to be. Because I have to have opinions. Everybody had their opinions of what went on. So what it did create, though, for better or worse, and I guess now at this point it doesn't matter, is that you're the man. You're in charge. You're the head coach. You had a great relationship with Douglas, who you'd worked with before. So are you okay with the perception that you are completely in control of this franchise?
Well, I mean, that wouldn't be true. I mean, Christopher Johnson has set it up to where Joe and myself are working together, and it's been really fun for me to be around him again. Mm. I mean, we were together that year, but we've had a tight relationship through his moves when he went to Philly. And to be with him again, I forgot how great of a dude he is, because every day it's like he is in my office. We're talking about something. We're talking about something that happened to, you know, them in the past to set up kind of their run for the Super Bowl. It's an energizing feeling for myself just being around him, just knowing where he's come from in his, you know, history with being with Baltimore. And in my head, I'm going, this guy has got three rings. He knows what it looks like. He knows how to set this thing up, man. We just got to follow his lead in that aspect, and then we got to do a great job coaching the players.
Yeah, I've watched thousands of hours of tape with a lot of different guys, with Bob Davey and Brock Ewart and Danny Cannell and, you know, Brian Greasy, all the guys I've worked with at ESPN. And a big part of getting ready for a college football game is you're in a film room for 5 or 6 hours on Friday, and I'm watching tape with these guys. And one thing I've learned over the years, no matter what any of their backgrounds are, whether they're a defensive guy, an offensive guy, defensive player, a quarterback, a running back, whatever they are, their eyes always go to the offensive line first. The jumping off point is the right guard a waistbender? Can the left guard move his feet? What's the footwork pattern? Is the center get it? Can we block them? And when you talk to Joe, the first words out of his mouth were, we're going to draft some offensive linemen.
It's all over.
Which didn't happen for a long time here. There have not been a lot of offensive linemen drafted. So I get, at least my impression, his philosophical way of looking at a team and how he wants to build it marries with what I've learned all these years of watching tape with all these guys. The first place their eyes go is the offensive line.
He has the expertise to be able to know the difference. I always say this. A lot of us can say, that's a first-round draft pick.
Mm-hmm.
But it's hard to say rounds 2 through 7 and free agent. Like,
exactly.
It starts to look the same to the majority of people. There's only so many guys that know how to really identify how a guy is going to be at this level. Mm-hmm. And he has that. He knows what it looks like. He takes a lot of pride in it because he was a lineman.
Sure.
And he'll always say, well, that's why I didn't. That's why I stopped where I stopped. But just knowing that that's important to him, especially with our quarterback, it's exciting to really get this thing going.
And the other side, too, is the D-line, right? It's that line. It's the battle at the line of scrimmage.
Yep.
Right? Otherwise, you're kind of freelancing, right?
Yep.
Any play that works when there's a breakdown on the offensive line is probably just kind of a fluke, right? So everything's got to work if you've got that balance. And then same on defense, right? You got to put pressure on the quarterback, got to stop the run. So that's it, right? That's the line of scrimmage.
Yeah, I think really the interior guys that we have, you can feel, like when we practice, and I'm looking over there and I'm going, God, I'm glad we don't have to play these guys. I'm sick of going against Leonard in a real game. I'm glad I'm on his side. Because every game we would be game planning, like, how do we get, two guys on him, four hands on him? And then it wouldn't matter. You'd split them.
Mm-hmm.
And to know he's on our team, but in practice, it's great for our offensive line because they're going against him, McClendon, Quinnen, Henry. It's just like those guys are – that's just a stout group.
Bob Bushews and Don LaGreca, 98.7 ESPN at Jet Camp on the K Show with the head coach, Adam Gase. Everyone learns something when they do a job once and then they get a chance to do it again. What are the things that you think you're now bringing lessons learned from Miami to here that's going to make you better at this job here than you were there?
That's a better question now than it was when I got hired. Because everybody would say that when I got hired. I'm like, I don't know. I haven't done this yet.
Right.
Like, we'll figure it out. Like, I just got fired 5 days ago or whatever it was. So when I look at kind of some of the things that we did in Miami and then we approach it now, I think communication with your coaching staff, just making sure everybody's on the same page, just that it's just constant. You can't assume somebody is good with something. And then a lot of these guys have been with me before. So I could easily do that now, but now it's like communicating with the players. Just making sure our practice schedule is set up for us, not what it was in Miami. And I think just learning all those little things, knowing what's important.
Mm-hmm.
Like before, everything was important because the first time you do it, the first year, it feels like everything is the most important thing ever. And now it's like, don't worry about that. Let's move to this. We need to focus on this, this, and this. You just prioritize things.
Do you think you were too much in the offensive silo in Miami? Do you feel like now you got to be the coach of the whole team? Although now you got a defensive coordinator that's been a head coach. So I guess there is that yin and that yang there. But, how do you adjust that philosophy of, all right, I'm the quarterback whisperer, I'm Sam's guy, I'm the offensive guru, but you're the head coach, the coach of the whole team. How do you balance that?
My first year in Miami, we had Vance Joseph was our defensive coordinator. We had a guy that got a head coaching job. He was pretty good.
Yeah, pretty good.
So, we're trying to get our stuff set on offense. And Vance and myself, we had a lot of conversations. I would say that right now, between Greg and myself, there's a lot of discussion that goes on there because we're both trying to do some things, and we're causing each other problems to where we have these discussions about why he does certain things and why I do certain things. And it's been fun for me to work with him because it's a challenge every day. Like today, we didn't have anything scripted. We were calling it. And then it's just like you start getting real competitive. I mean, it's fun. Those are the best practices. I know Sam was jacked up last night.
Yeah.
When he goes, I'm so glad we're finally doing call-up periods. Like, now it feels, that's going to feel real. And then that first series, like, start calling plays. When you call plays with him, it just feels different for me. It's like, you're playing Battleship. You're just like, this kid will make, he'll make plays.
It's just amazing. It's so good to Jet fans to hear that because, it's a quarterback's league, right? I mean, you can have the best defense. I just can't wrap my mind around a team it working without the quarterback.
It's fun.
Well, I've described. I'm almost 48 years old, so I am literally the worst possible age to be a Jet fan because I have no memory of Namath. Namath was a Ram when I was like 7 years old. So literally my whole life of watching this team, they've been looking, trying to find that next guy. And this seems to be as sure as anybody's ever been that you got him.
Yeah, I mean,
he could be that good.
I think the great thing about Sam is he's such a worker. He never the comparison anything like that, yep. And he's focused on the right things.
Just zero entitlement, right? I mean, zero.
None
of that.
He works like his goal every day, like because we got the GPS stuff, sure. all mm-hmm. that stuff, and every day he's like, I'm gonna have the most yards. You'll see him running, and I'm like, is this good or bad? Like. I'm sure some sports science guys out there going, like, he shouldn't run that much, you know, or something like that.
When you see, like, there's been times where, you know, it just works for a quarterback. He's a great quarterback. He's a Hall of Fame quarterback. And then you see some quarterbacks, like, we had Mark Sanchez here, drafted fifth overall. We go to the playoffs first 2 years. Doesn't work. Is it just that? Do you have it in you? Does the quarterback have it and he just has to be fine-tuned? Or is it really just being in the right system, being in the right place to get the most out of that player? What makes it work?
I think it's just every guy's so different. I mean, think of Rich Gannon, how long he went, and everybody was like, yeah, he never amounted. And then all of a sudden he's the MVP of the NFL because him and Gruden just connected the right way. And there's some of that. And then there's some guys that are just, he can be in any system and he'll have success and win and put up great numbers.
Because I always just wonder, is it just that there aren't a lot of great quarterbacks or just not a lot of great systems? Can a bad system ruin a great quarterback? Or does a great quarterback just find a way?
I don't think a bad system can ruin a great quarterback.
Okay.
Those guys, when you're around one of those guys, there's a reason why they're great. Because they're relentless.
Mm-hmm.
And you can't throw a bad system in front of them because they'll shred you. The great ones are they're so knowledgeable. It's like getting in an argument with a coach. I mean,
right.
And then they have the ball.
Right.
So, I mean, you're probably going to lose that battle. I don't know. Like, the guys that are probably above average and then get in a great system and they have the surrounding cast, that's where you can see a guy that would be like, I never thought that was going to happen. And, you know, he turns into a really good player.
Speaking of one of those kind of guys, the best things that you took from working with Peyton that have impacted you and that you're now able to impart on a young guy like Sam,
There's probably, I'm glad everything was documented, like, with video. Like, he has so many things that he has access to. I mean, like, we have all, like, he had so much stuff when he was mic'd up and that never aired and things that he could see, like, how he operated in practice and at the line of scrimmage. Like, he just can watch all that stuff. And, you know, things will come up and we'll be like, we did it this because, you know, we thought this, but he saw it like this, and that's why we came to that on the offense. You know, like, he's heard a lot of these stories and he's watched a lot of this stuff.
Right.
And that's great for him.
What do you think the biggest takeaways he's had so far from getting that inside look kind of behind the curtain?
I don't know. You'd have to ask him.
Yeah.
I mean, that's hard for me to say. I mean, it seems like he pays attention to it, though. He asks a lot of questions. He'll ask about it.
You got, like, a good question? Like, what's the question that kind of opened your eyes? Like, wow, that's a really good question.
No, it's just the little details of things. Like, what did he do with the signals? You know, when he's at the line of scrimmage, the formations, how is he communicating? What's he saying to the line? He just, those little tiny details that,
cool.
you know, that Peyton developed on his own. You know, that's the thing. Like, a lot of the things that he did, that was him doing it.
Has he talked to Sam?
No, I mean, there'll come a time and a place for that. I mean, you know, hopefully he comes visit his brother one of these days.
Mm-hmm. And we can stops by.
Get him over here.
Yeah.
Yeah, he said he didn't want to work because he didn't want to have to analyze his brother. That's one of the reasons why he didn't want to do Monday Night Football.
Yeah, I know. We played him in 13 up here, and I remember that. That was he was not interested in that discussion. That family is very close, and yeah. I don't think he ever liked that when they played each other.
It's got to be hard.
Yeah, you know, I mean,
never worked out for Eli.
I know he obviously wanted to win, because I don't think he ever lost to him.
No, he hasn't. They lost to him in Indianapolis. Lost to him. Denver came here, beat him up pretty good. But that's we find it fascinating doing a show in New York with Eli. Like, I'd love to get your expert opinion on it. I know it's a rival, same town. You play them this year, but it's like he's. You look at his numbers, and his numbers are very good. But he's going to the Hall of Fame based on those two runs to the Super Bowl. So, like, when you look at Eli, do you look at him as a Hall of Fame quarterback, even though maybe the numbers in the regular season may say something else?
That's hard. It's hard for me to comment on that because that's like I'm not the one to determine that. I always look at it like this. When he's gotten in the playoffs, I don't know how to say it, but the guy's got big balls. So.
Right. Yeah. But it's not luck.
I mean, he's just – he had a different, his focus and his ability and his fearlessness, like, that's what got him two rings.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they beat New England doing it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, everybody teed it up, hey, undefeated season. And he's like, all right, we'll see. he has a calmness about him. When, you know, the times I've been around him, I've always appreciated that you can tell this guy's, he's steady.
Yeah. Is Peyton like that too?
I think they're just different.
Like, yeah, they do seem to be different.
When it's like when the bullets are flying and it's a 2-minute drive to go win a game, like Peyton is like this. Like during the week, he's getting after a lot of people.
That's awesome. Listen, best of luck this year.
I appreciate it.
Great talking to you. The beard looks fantastic. You're going to keep the beard because it looks great.
We'll see. We'll see. Day to day.
Like we are. Aren't we all?
Just be careful because you go into the season and then you keep winning, then you're gonna you can't cut it.
No choice.
Yeah,
to keep it.
And you look like I don't know if you follow hockey. Joe Thornton had that big one. It was like almost down to his chest.
ZZ Top by the time you get to December.
It happens.
And you're the right age because like I tried to do that and I look like Santa Claus. You don't have to worry about that.
It'd be a good look for you.
It wasn't a good look.